He sits on that panel along with several others. We are looking at fracking, I've been told, and we're looking into the research that's been done and can be done safely, that it is certainly a game changer. We talked earlier about an energy policy, and that should be included in an energy policy as the development of natural gas. We've not staked out a position, but I think certainly because of the Marcellus Shale, because of the Utica Shale, it's certainly something that we should explore as a nation because it makes us energy independent. And if it is done safely and carefully, it is something that we should really consider. Where's the second question?
Do you feel that people should be encouraged to grow their own food, and do you feel it is important to have genetically modified foods labeled?
You know, of course people, if they want to grow their own foods, they should be able to grow their own foods. Agriculture is the leading industry in New York State, and I think we have to, we just passed 3 free trade agreements to help our farmers with exports. The Port of Oswego is an excellent, they truck soy and corn over from Kiowa County, comes over on a rail and shipped out to China. We should be encouraging that kind of development to grow and to help the farmers. Unfortunately, we have not passed a farm bill yet, but we will consider it when we go back. But making sure our farmers have what they need. The needs of farmers are different depending whether you're in fruit or food or dairy or otherwise. I will say, it was brought up earlier about what our farmers are going through right now because of the frost. They've lost substantial amounts throughout the 4 counties, Wayne County. They lost their specialty fruits, their cherries, their peaches. Many lost 50-67% of their apple crop, and that becomes not only for food sources here locally, it becomes a problem, but for jobs. And at the end of the day, the gentleman over here talked about issues this election, and what we're talking about has to do with jobs in the economy and how we're going to get upstate New York, Oswego County, Onondaga County, get the people back to work, get policies in place. Whether it's in agriculture or any other manufacturing, Oswego County has sustained some terrible blows. And we've got to get the American people back to work. We've got to get policies into place that the government gets out of the way, and we encourage the private sector, we encourage businesses, we encourage corporations to come in to this district, and we get the people back to work. And when we do that, we strengthen Medicare, we strengthen Social Security, we strengthen all of the programs that are so important to the American people.
So I think I'm going to answer those questions in reverse order. Yes, I support the labeling of GMO foods. I think it's our right to know what we eat and what's in our food so we can make the best choices. And yes, I support people growing their own food. I live in a house where we have about 1/2 acre behind our house, and we grow our own tomatoes and other vegetables, and we basically eat them all summer, and it's really great, and I think it's important to think of policies as part of the Farm Bill that can promote more localized food production and promote food independence and food security. And in terms of fracking, I think you can see my button, and I do oppose fracking, and I think it is a federal issue because air and water know no state boundaries, and so I think it's important for Congress to take a position on the issue, and I do not support the Obama administration's all of the above energy policy that includes support for fracking. We've seen what's happened in the neighboring state of Pennsylvania. Very unfortunate well contamination. People's health has been negatively affected. And ultimately, it's a boom and bust industry. Pennsylvania also saw economic promises from the gas men. And the economy has not improved in the state of Pennsylvania. It is not a model we want to be replicating here in New York. And I think the role of a representative, whether or not we are crafting legislation at the state level, I think is also to be someone that rallies the community and rallies the district behind policies that will benefit the district. And you know, to say that there's safe fracking is like saying that there's such a thing as clean coal. We have to be looking, we have to have a long-term perspective. And the truth is that there are more jobs in renewable energy if we make the commitment to develop renewable energy. For every dollar invested in jobs in the oil and gas industry, the equal investment could create 3 to 4 times as many jobs in renewable energy if we just had the political courage and the political will to make that choice. And so my opponent, Anne-Marie Burkle, says we have to get government out of the way and allow corporations to come here. And I say, hell no, I do not want New York to turn into Pennsylvania. I think we need to protect our air, protect our water, protect our health, and look towards the future. And I want to see a carbon-free, nuclear-free New York.
Our next question is from Chris Jamison of Syracuse. Would you like to ask your question?
I think I will.
Okay.
I'll read my own question.
Oh, sure. Perhaps, would you have you come to the front and start the phone?
Well, I'll talk loud. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
My question deals with the economic cost of the war on terror. And I don't want to ignore the human cost. Everybody in this room should know, over 250,000 people died, and that includes 9,000 Americans, 3,000 on one day. Over 400,000 people have been wounded, and over 7 million people have been displaced because of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. But my question is that since 9/11, neither Democrat or Republican presidents or Congresses, have increased anyone's taxes to pay for our war on terror. We have always in the past raised taxes to pay for our wars. This time, Congress cut taxes. Last year, it was reported that the bill for our wars in Iraq, Afghanistan, and the drone war in Pakistan totaled $4 trillion. $4 trillion. It is rapidly increasing as we sit here tonight. My question is, when and how are we going to pay for these wars?
Thanks for your question, Chris. And I think, you should be thinking about when and how are we going to pay. We have to think about how we're going to pay for them. We have to think about how we're going to change course and stop spending so much money on military adventures in other countries when we're not meeting people's needs here in our country. And so I think, you know, one thing that you didn't mention as part of the war on terror, for example, is to increase domestic surveillance through the National Defense Authorization Act, that increased the ability of the government to prosecute whistleblowers that might be speaking out about government corruption. And so I think that these are all things to be really worried about. I think there's a civil liberties perspective on this issue, and also a very serious budget perspective on this. And the Congressional Budget Office has identified the unfunded wars in Iraq and Afghanistan as significant contributors to the deficit. So I think we need to be looking at our military spending and bringing it back to 2000 levels before we went into Iraq and Afghanistan. And also, we need to, if Congress and the President decide to go to war, we need to think about how are we going to pay for those wars and not be borrowing to pay for these military adventures. And so, and you mentioned the U.S.'s illegal drone program in Pakistan and Yemen, and I think these are very serious issues to talk about as part of the war on terror, because really, we have to ask who's being a terrorist. I think about how would I feel if there were unmanned planes flying over my community? A recent study came out from Stanford and NYU saying that the US drone wars have increased insecurity for our country by increasing hostility against the US in other countries because of the high rates of civilian casualties, and also because we're using them in countries that the US has not declared war against. So I think there's a civil liberties issue to be addressed and the budget issue. And so the short answer is we need to look at cutting the military budget to a responsible level to maintain our national security and to acknowledge that the actions of the current administration and the previous administration have not made us safer as a nation.
When I first began speaking tonight, we talked about the proper role of government And if the Constitution is the blueprint that we follow for this country, one of the legitimate functions of the federal government is national security. It is a military, and it is keeping Americans safe. If you look at the military budget, the amount of money that's spent on defense, and I printed this out because I wanted to make sure I had the number, the overall budget, military spending accounts for 19.2% of the federal budget. It's not the reason we are in debt. It's not the reason there is a deficit. It is a legitimate part of government, and that is our national security. Beyond that, we talk about the entitlements, Medicare, Social Security, those issues, we have to address those. They are what the largest contributors to our debt and our deficit are. It was brought up with the NDAA and the Defense Authorization Bill. There was concern about civil liberties, and there was the Landry Amendment was passed to address that. But the legitimate role of government in all that is going on and all of the uncertainty in the Middle East, it is incumbent upon this nation to have peace through strength. This administration and its policies are weakened this country. Our military is stretched so thin. And I will tell you this, I mentioned sequestration earlier, the cuts to defense through sequestration will be $500 billion. The president's budget included another cut to defense, $500 billion. Ladies and gentlemen, whether you agree or you disagree with these wars, and whether it's time to come home, and I think Americans are truly war weary, and rightly so. If we deploy men and women, we have a moral obligation as a country to make sure they have exactly what they need to remain as safe as they can. Given the fact that these men and women voluntarily agree to go into service, to uphold the Constitution, and to keep all of us safe, so we can sit in this room tonight, so we can have differences and agreements on the issues, and we can decide the course that we want our nation to take and we want our district to take. So, I'm very concerned with these cuts coming to the military, both because of the jeopardy that will take on our military, but also because of in upstate New York we have a lot of defense companies, and they will also take a hit, and once again it goes back to jobs and the economy, and they will be